part two, make sure you watch part one of this video if you haven't. Otherwise, none of this is going to make any sense to you. Yeah. The link will be right here in the cards. And so step four in solving this damn problem is fragments. This is what I learned in these last 3 years. You don't want to look at your shift tables yet at all. Not really. The common mistake is to start browsing through your shift table and see like what these things can be, but a lot of times that gets really confusing, especially because a lot of things fall in the 2 to 5 range. We don't have that many here, so it's actually not as hard if you were to use shift tables, but I'll teach you what I mean by fragments. Iconic, notorious, infamous, your choice. So my fragments, a more detailed page is actually on Instagram, which is nowhere to be found. Okay, perfect. Alright, yeah, so my notorious fragments post is on Instagram, and if you scroll down here, right here. Here we go. These are some of the iconic NMR fragments. When you have 6 hydrogens with 0 neighbors, it's almost guaranteed to be 2 methyl groups and a carbon, and this carbon can't be attached to any hydrogens, because otherwise, if it was, then these 6 hydrogens would have a neighbor, like this. So I probably need to tweak this. But anyways, the one that I really wanted to start with is actually right here, 6 hydrogens and 1 neighbor. How can you get 6 hydrogens and only 1 neighbor, meaning 1 hydrogen that's different within 3 bonds distance? Kind of get already gave it away, but it's right here. Alright, so it is a CH3 bonded to two CH3s bonded to a carbon, and then they have to have a hydrogen within 3 bonds distance. So this is hydrogen H, I'll use black. Hydrogen H, hydrogen H, 6 hydrogens, 1 neighbor, H, and this, who is that guy? We don't know, because we have so many 1 hydrogens, right? But there is only 1 hydrogen that has at least 6 neighbors. And that's the best part. This is kind of called coupling. So this hydrogen is coupled with this guy, because these 6 hydrogens, they have 1 neighbor. Well, then this 1 neighbor also must have at least 6 neighbors as well. It's just kind of logic. So, and the only 1 hydrogen here that has at least 6 neighbors is G. So that's how we know that this is hydrogen G. And my marker's dying. Okay. Hydrogen G. There you go, much better. Alright, so that's a fragment. And then you ask yourself, okay, well, if this is hydrogen G, and we know that it has 8 neighbors, well then, the only way for this to work out reasonably is if it's attached to another atom, and that atom has 2 hydrogens. Coming off a bit. And now G has 8 neighbors, okay? And you might be asking, isn't that complex splitting? Yes, it is complex splitting. But for this problem, don't think too much into it, but we're not taking into account complex splitting in this problem, because these hydrogens are different from these hydrogens. So technically, you shouldn't be getting a non-net or 8 neighbors. You should be getting something like a triplet of septets or a septets of triplets, but don't worry about that. Okay, so we did that. So we're good with H, we're good with G. Well, then the next part is you keep working off your fragment. Who are these guys then? Well, look at that. There's only another group, well, 1 group with 2 hydrogens. So these guys must be F. Boom, 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 F. All right, so we just found F. Well, then F has 1 neighbor, and that makes sense because G is F's neighbor. So we did that. These are all taken care of. And next, so at this point here, F has 1 neighbor, we found it. So then if you continue the chain, this has to be attached to something else, but we don't know what, because F only has 1 neighbor, so there can't be any hydrogens over here. So you kind of just give up, to be honest, for this fragment at least. And you go back to what I was saying earlier, part one, which is we know for sure that we have a benzene in here because we're DOU once again, and we check the Actually, can you go back to the spectrum? Perfect. We know there's definitely a benzene here because, once again, we have four signals in the benzene range, and we have a DOU of 5, so there's a really damn good chance. So, let's take care of that and draw him in. Benzene. Alright, draw our benzene in. And so, essentially, we are going to find where these fragments are, or these four hydrogens that are all within the benzene shift range. And this is another thing I learned. There is apparently only 3 unique ways that you can set up a benzene with 4 hydrogens. And I'm actually gonna have Lyndon show you guys.
So as Frank said, there are only 3 arrangements for 4 hydrogens on a benzene. So if you wanna pause this video, try those 3 arrangements out and get back to us, then that'd be great. So hopefully if you did this on your own, you got something that kind of looks like this. 3 possibilities. And so the first possibility, which I denoted A right here, has all hydrogens adjacent to each other. And so the important thing that you want to take away from these images is the hydrogen and their neighbors. So if we look at A, we see that this hydrogen has 1 neighbor, this hydrogen has 2 neighbors, this hydrogen also has 2 neighbors, and this hydrogen also has 1 neighbor. If we look at B, this hydrogen has no neighbors. This one has 1, this one has 2, and this one also has 1. So like the last one, C, we can see that these all have 1 neighbor. And so what you want to do in regards to our problem is take these and compare it to your awesome table over here to see which arrangement makes sense the most. So if we look at A, we know that this one has 2 neighbors, 1 neighbor, or sorry, 1 neighbor, 2 neighbors, 2 neighbors, and 1 neighbor. So if we go to our awesome table here, and we look at the hydrogens within the benzene shift, we see that 1 hydrogen has 1 neighbor, 1 hydrogen has 2 neighbors, 1 hydrogen also has 2 neighbors again, and 1 hydrogen also has 1 neighbor again, which pairs exactly with what we got with A. So what you want to do is think of all possible arrangements and then compare to your shift table, or not your shift table, your awesome table, and then see which one makes the most sense.
Yeah, exactly. Awesome. Great job. Alright, so I'm going to hand back the camera. Alright, so let's go back to purple. So now we know that, thanks to Lyndon, that the structure has to have this setup of hydrogens on the benzene ring. And we just found a whole bunch of stuff. So another trick I learned that you can do sometimes, you don't always need to do it, but I'll do it over here. So C11, H14, O3. All right, so we know that we've accounted for a whole bunch of carbons already. There's 6 on the benzene ring. Let's see, 7, 8, 9, 10. So now you can subtract 10 here. Oxygens, we haven't really addressed that yet, but we'll get to that in 1 second, because what we didn't quite do in the beginning is we didn't read the question properly. And this happened when we were practicing too. But it actually told us that there's an ester and an alcohol. And that's awesome, because an ester has 2 oxygens and an alcohol has 1 oxygen, and that fulfills all 3 oxygens. So that fragment is actually an ester. Do you remember your functional groups? We actually have a video on functional groups, which I'll link to the cards over here. But this is a ester, carbon. So this is an ester and an alcohol. They told us is in there as well. So we have an OH attached to a carbon as well. Now at this point here, you might be like, wait, that's way too many carbons, right? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, blah, 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 way too many. Well then, that's how we know that some of these carbons must be repeated. And for example, this carbon here might be this carbon, or it could be this carbon, or it could be this carbon. And at first, your brain might explode because you're like, holy crap, what do I do now? But I'll show you how to break it down. 3 oxygens, let's subtract that first, -3. These 6 carbons are unique for sure because they're benzene. These methyls have to be here and they're unique. This has to be here. This had to be an atom having 2 hydrogens, which I said earlier. But so it can't be an oxygen, because if this is an oxygen, you can't have 3 bonds and be stable, because oxygen likes to have only 2 bonds. So these are the only guaranteed carbons so far. 6 here, 7, 8, 9, 10, and then 11. Because this is unique as well. Oh yeah, so there you go. We just figured it out. 1, because the carbonyl is just a carbonyl, it can't change. And this can't be a carbonyl carbon, this can't be a carbonyl carbon. So I'll label it in purple. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, unique, 8, 9, 10, 11. These all have to be your carbons. So we actually already accounted for all our carbons. So 0 carbons left, 0 oxygens, and you don't care about subtracting hydrogens because when you have the correct structure, it'll all be fulfilled. So now, everything's been accounted for other than these mysterious carbons here. So we need to figure out who are these guys, pretty much, and connect these fragments together, and you have your answer right there. All right, so going back to the shift table, we figured out...
awesome table.
Yeah. All right, so going back to the awesome table, we just figured out pretty much the four hydrogens on the benzene, so E, D, C, B, figured them out. We don't really need to label them, but we know that for sure, B and E, the one hydrogens with one neighbors, must be these guys. One hydrogens with one neighbor. Yeah. And C and D must be one of these guys. One hydrogens with two neighbors. So, yeah. So now we just gotta connect everything together. And the other tricky part is, when you know that you have esters, you gotta be careful, because the ester can attach on like this, or you can flip it. Like, meaning, what I mean is, like, we already know that these are all our carbons, so let's say this carbon 6 is this guy. Well, this carbon 6 can also be this guy. Your ester could be flipped depending on how you connect it. So how do you figure it out, right? Well then, let's see. Oh, we also have another thing. We'll talk about this in a second, but we pretty much know for sure that this is our OH hydrogen, because that's the only, well, it's one hydrogen. And there's many things, but this video is getting a little complicated, but one more fun fact: OH hydrogens and NH2 hydrogens, or pretty much any OH or NH hydrogens, they undergo hydrogen bonding, so they'll never have any neighbors. That they can never be split in NMR. They always appear as a singlet. So that's one reason why I know that this OH hydrogen is this 10.9 signal right here. All right, so now putting everything together. Alright, so if your heads haven't exploded here, then props to you, but we're a little bit, we're like right there right now, and how you rationalize this last bit is, well, these carbons can't really exist because we already have our 11 carbons. So let's start with the alcohol, for example, A. So this carbon has to be either carbons 6, 7, or 11, right? Well, let's think about it. It makes sense for, or it could be on a 7 or a 6, because a benzene is pretty, anything that's close to benzene, it brings the hydrogens very, very downfield. And I know we're talking about OH and not an H exactly, but it also has an effect of bringing it downfield or a higher number. And going back to here, if it's on 11, if this is the OH, well then we have a big problem, because your fragment is stuck. You can't connect your fragment to the rest of your molecule, because carbon only likes four bonds and 1, 2, 3, 4. Done. So there's no way that this could be carbon 11. So this is either carbon 6 or 7, and it really doesn't matter which one, because it's the same. If this goes here, then something else goes here. If this goes here, something else goes down there. So let's just say this is carbon 7. So now, you're good with that? Well, here we go. OH. And all that's left is carbon 6 and 11. I'll erase this because it's probably a little more confusing. Yeah, so is this carbon 6 or carbon 11? Is this carbon 6 or carbon 11? Well, we can use carbon 11 to help us out, because we know the shift of the hydrogens on carbon 11 due to our awesome table and our NMR table. But carbon 11 has hydrogens F, and their shifts are 4.4, so we take a look at our shift table. 4.4 is, well, in the alkene range, but we know we definitely don't have an alkene because we can't afford that with our 5 degrees of unsaturation, which has already been accounted for by our carbonyl and our benzene. So the closest thing, well, it's either benzene, but that's not possible. 11 can't be a benzene because you can't have that many hydrogens attached on one carbon. So the closest thing is actually a HCO, which is right here, HCO. And that's kind of what I was talking about earlier when about how esters can be flipped, because you technically this could be carbon 11 as well, but because of the shifts, it's at 4.4, which corresponds to this spot, What would be the shifts if the hydrogens were off this carbon? Take a look. All right, hit pause if you need to, but the shifts would correspond with a HC carbonyl bond. HC carbonyl. So, and that's at 2.0 to 2.2, which is nowhere to be found here. It's at 4.4. So it makes much more sense for this to be carbon 11. Carbon 11, so this is essentially, the oxygen is connected to here. And we can erase this. And then, so who's left? Carbon 6. This is carbon 6, aka this is connected to here. So I'll draw it all together for you guys so you can get a nice solid structure. For your NMR. Alright. I know that was kind of a marathon there, but thank you for keeping up with me. And that's essentially how you solve hard NMR and how you make a hard NMR more easier for yourself. Just to recap, step one, degrees of unsaturation. If it's greater than or equal to 4, check for benzene immediately. Step two, integration, you just do integration. Step three, Lawson table, make sure you do that. It organizes all your information. And then you can look for coupling. Just like what we did for this fragment right here. And you look for fragments, your iconic fragments, you can check out our Instagram for that. What else? It just organizes everything too. And then build off your fragments. When you're stuck, give up, jump to another fragment, and then just piece them all together, pretty much. You have to use a bit of logic and stuff, but those are my tips. Do you have any tips, Lyndon, for this?
Nope, sounds good.
Okay, cool. Alright, so if you liked this video, make sure you like it down there, and if you want to get updated when we make new videos, make sure you hit subscribe or hit that bell button, gives you email notifications. And if you want to help donate and help support these videos, you can do so on our Patreon page or our GoFundMe page. The link is all down there in the description of this video. So, yeah, thanks for watching, and I'll see you guys in another video, and thank you, Lyndon, as well.
See ya.
Alright, bye guys. Oh, wait, shoot, I forgot. There is another video. We have another example problem for you guys to do. Lyndon is going to be doing hard NMR made easy problem 2 in another video. So the link of which will be in the cards right over here or in the descriptions down below. So be sure to check that out if you want extra practice for your exam. Bye guys.